Okay, thank you, Wijnand. Thank you, Bram. I'm happy to give a presentation on the work we're doing in Maastricht. And as Bram said, the patients have become a family, but I must say I feel always also becoming a member of the MDC1A family in the Netherlands. And that's a very motivating aspect of doing the research together. What I will talk about is the work we do in Maastricht on regenerative medicine, on muscle stem cell treatment therapy, which we would like to develop for MDC1A as well. And as you will see in during this evening, there were many different ways where people try to find an effective treatment for MDC1A. And it may be that it may be become a joint effort of all of them to be eventually successful. Let me see. Yeah, what are we planning to do in Maastricht? So I hope you can see my cursor. What we want to do is to treat the patients with MDC1A and other muscle disease with their own muscle stem cells. And how we do it is that we extract from a muscle biopsy, which we can take from the arm of the leg. We extract muscle stem cells. We can culture them, but if there is a genetic defect in the muscle stem cells, then we need to correct it, because if you would culture them and give them back, you would bring back the wrong cells again. So what we try to do is to correct the stem cells we get from the muscle, and the repaired ones, we culture them, so we select the ones which have been repaired, we expand them, and then we bring them back into the muscle through the bloodstream. So what we use is a specific type of adult muscle stem cell. They are called mesangioblasts. And the way we try to correct the genetic defect, and I think Dwi Kamladevi will comment on that later also during her presentation, is CRISPR-Cas9 based correction strategy. And to assure you that that is a very good method to do it, this year the Nobel Prize for Chemistry was awarded to the two women who invented this type of correction strategy. So basically, we want to treat the patient with their own cells in which the genetic defect has been corrected. Well, how does that work? So the mesangioblasts, these are the muscle stem cells, and these can then develop into myotubes, and they can develop into myofibers, but they can make myotubes and myofibers themselves, but they also can join existing myofibers. And why is that important? So they can bring in healthy cells, which makes proteins or repair the deficiencies which are there. But because they also fuse with existing fibers, they can also bring the treatment into the fibers which are already there in the body and make the existing fibers express proteins which they didn't do before. So mesangioblasts are muscle stem cells that differentiate into novel myofibers or fuse with existing one, as I said. The potential to do that is 10 times higher than for other muscle stem cells, so they're way more effective than others. And you can culture them very well. So you can culture them in 25 passages, which means that the whole culture divides 25 times, which means that you can get up to 4.5 billion cells, which would mean that this would be sufficient for a whole body treatment of your muscles. And what's specifically important, those mesangioblasts you can inject in the bloodstream, and then through the bloodstreams, it moves into the muscle. So the cells are able to go from the bloodstream into the damaged muscle, which is also a quite effective way of reaching all your muscle cells. Well, on the left-hand side, you see how we can do it. So we have a patient with a genetic muscle disease. We have mesangioblasts with the mutation. We correct them. When they're mutation-free, we expand them, and we inject them again back to the patient in order to restore the muscle disease. However, we also have patients have non-genetic myopathy, there needs to be an end there, or who have healthy stem cells by themselves. And for this group of patients, we can use a shortcut. They make mutation-free mesangioblasts themselves, which we can expand and put back. This is obviously not the MDC1A patients because they are in road two, but this patients in road one, they allow us to test the efficacy of the treatment at an early stage. And I showed you here that in the right-hand side, so it's a patient with a different disease, but it is also a muscle disease. It's a defect in the powerhouses of the cell, the mitochondria. And these patients, they have a lot of bad mitochondria due to a genetic defect in the muscle, but their muscle stem cells, they are fully normal, which means that from these patients, we can isolate these healthy muscle stem cells, culture them, and bring them back. So these patients are ideally suited to test and optimize the therapeutic strategy with healthy autologous means of your own, so the stem cells from yourself. How are we going to do that? And this is a clinical trial which we already started last year, but indeed due to all the measures taken to prevent COVID-19 from spreading, all these trials have unfortunately been delayed. So what we are currently doing is set up or executing a phase 1/2 clinical trial, which is aimed at safety. Huh? Is it safe to inject so many cells into your body? And limited efficacy, and that is we look at the muscle to see CV improvement. So here is how it goes at these type of treatments. So you have a patient, you examine him, you take a blood sample and a muscle biopsy. From the muscle biopsy, you culture the stem cells. We label them, we color them to be able in the end to discriminate the new cells from the existing ones. The culture time is about 6 to 8 weeks. The patient will be examined again. They will get 50 million cells in the artery in one leg, and the other leg is the control. After a day after injection, the patient will be physically examined again. Again, a muscle biopsy is taken from both legs, the injected and the non-injected one. So the non-injected leg is the control for the injected one. And after 4 weeks, we take again a muscle biopsy to see if there's any result of the injection of the cells. So for the first phase 1/2 trial, what are we going to test? So we are going to test at the first day after injection whether it's safe. So, and this part of the treatment, the patients have to stay at the intensive care, which, as you all might understand, that these days it's very difficult to execute these type of trials because the intensive cares are taken by the COVID-19 patients. But there we look at acute adverse events. We look at the angiogram at the injection site, if there's any blockages. We look at inflammation. So we look at a number of things which have to do with the safety. After 4 weeks, we do it again. We look at inflammation markers. And in the end, we look at the treated versus the untreated leg to see in the muscle biopsy of how many of the novel cells, which are labeled IC green, you can find in those muscles, so how effective the treatment has been, and how many new muscle fibers have been generated by these cells. So in this way, well, we have started up this trial. As I said, we had hoped that we had already finished it, but we're now currently in the first phase yet. So we're trying to identify the patients which we can do. And hopefully within half a year or at the middle of next year, we hope to be able to tell you that injection of healthy stem cells has a positive effect on your muscle and on your muscle pile. So that's how we first try it. And then what do we do about MDC1A with those cells? I told you we need to correct the genetic defect, and that's exactly what we will proceed upon. A bit of background for you. So this is a muscle fiber. This is the external scaffold where the muscle fiber is embedded in, and that fiber is attached to that scaffold by a number of proteins. And one of the anchoring proteins is SLAMA2. So here you have a defect in your patients. So the anchor is gone, which means that your muscle, which should be carefully attached to the membrane by this anchor point, is letting loose. And then you see that the muscle, which is supposed to be healthy, is going to be redundant. This is a cartoon of Kamala Dawi of Dwi, and probably she will show it later on and explain it in more detail for you. And what we are going to do with MDC1A LAMA2 in the Netherlands, it's, as Bram already said, a collaboration between Nijmegen and Maastricht. So in Nijmegen, they will do the clinical work, the natural history, the clinical follow-up. And I think Carlijn Bouwman will talk about that later. What we will do, we got ethical approval to isolate, to get mesangioblasts, Florence got them, to isolate mesangioblasts from LAMA2 patients. So we will further analyze them, and then we will go to the correction strategy. And there's a number of ways you can correct your muscle cells. I'll still not go into full detail, but if you have corrected them by either way, you should be able then to select the ones which produce the LAMA2 protein again. You can expand them, analyze them, and then give them back. And for the correction, we can probably rely on a comparable strategy as we, Kemal Adewi, had done in the mouse model of MDC1A. Because if you want to correct LAMA2 mutations, you enter into a problem, because here you see the dots. All the dots are different mutations, and here also different mutations. All the signs depict a different mutation in the LAMA2 gene, which is depicted here, which means that it's genetically heterogeneous, as we call, that you have very many different ways the disease can be caused. And it also means that you have many private mutations. And the problem for that is that if you want to correct a genetic defect, you need to correct each genetic defect for the specific family involved. However, when we look at the Dutch MDC1A mutations, and Bram already said that the patients became some kind of family, but basically they are literally family from each other, most likely, because if you look at the mutations, about half of the patients, they all have the same mutation. So the numbers which you see here is depicts a place in the gene which is mutated. And if you see a sign like this, a bigger sign, then it means that the G is changed into a C. Well, in the Netherlands, 16 patients have been tested, 9 have these mutations, and 5 even, or 4 even only in both genes have this same mutation. And this is good for the correction strategy we like to develop, because if we would develop a correction strategy for this mutation, that would already be beneficial for more than half of the patients. So we would not need to have a specific correction procedure for every patient again. And this mutation very much looks like the mutation which has been corrected in the mouse model. So with the CRISPR-Cas9 strategy, we might be able to do it in the same way, or we will use an alternative approach, which obviously I will not go into full detail on that again. And as Wienand already said, we are trying to expand these type of procedures and these type of processes. And basically the whole concept of muscle treatment and having autologous muscle stem cells recovering your muscle, you can take that much broader. And we took that into a higher level, and we got a 2.7 million grant from the EU, which is connecting different universities in our region. So from Liège, from Leuven, from Aachen, and Maastricht. And they work together on developing the muscle stem cell therapy a bit further. And what we have three axes, and the slide is a bit busy, so I will not go to you in full detail, but we have the clinical trial, so it's what I talked in the beginning, to show that administering healthy stem cells is safe and effective. And we would also like to see who can benefit from these treatments. So we know that the patients at MDC1A can, we know that other patients can, but also patients like cancer patients or stroke patients, these might also benefit from the same type of treatment. And you might wonder, well, what does this mean for MDC1A? Well, the benefit can be that it can be more easy for us to raise the extensive resources to do our research, and that MDC1A can benefit from these type of projects which have been acquired before. And what we further would like to do is to improve the production, to improve the homing, and that more cells enter the muscle. We want to improve the regenerative capacity of the cells, that they create better stem cells. And we also would like to create a spin-off to produce these mesangioblasts. And we think by keeping it in our hand that we also can control the costs, because as you know, that many of those rare diseases, the costs are huge of treating them. And by trying to be in control of it ourselves, we hope that we can develop a treatment which we can bring on the market at a cost-effective manner. So coming to a summary of my talk, and I think I'm still right doing on time. So what we are developing in Maastricht is the administration of autologous healthy mesangioblasts as a therapeutic strategy for genetic and non-genetic muscle disease. A clinical trial is ongoing to test the safety and efficacy. More than 50% of the Dutch MDC1A patients carry the same LAMA2 defect, so their family probably, but we have to prove that. We're developing a correction strategy for LAMA2 in these cells, and we hope to make some progress in the next half years. And similar models have already developed for the MDC1A mouse model, which is a defect which looks very much like the founder. And we have already also optimized these correction procedures by also doing that on other genetic muscle disease. And as I said, the GYM project is paving the way for general autologous muscle stem cell therapy, which might then be a broadly accepted treatment for many of us. On the bottom line, you see the funding agencies we have, and we're very proud that FOSARA has selected us as one of the big investments they would like to proceed upon. I made a summary in Spanish as well. Resumen, I will not going to read it, and because I don't want to hurt the ears of our Spanish viewers, so I will just give it to you later on. And these are the people involved. So I consider also Bram part of our team, and these are the people from Maastricht. So it's Janneke from Neurology, Florence, which is one of the most important scientists in this project, René de Coe, who was the neurologist who initiated this, Leo, the PhD student working on, and Rosella, who recently started, and she's going to follow on the correction strategy. Janneke, the neurology, I probably said, and this is the matching team in Nijmegen. So it's Nicole Voermans, Carlijn, who you will see later on, and Corey, who I saw also attending this meeting. I want to thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your story, Bert. And I see that due to time constraints, we won't be able to answer all questions in the chat. So I take the liberty of doing two of them. And the first one is, how much does this treatment cost and often, and how often does it have to be done, and does it work on kids?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is a question we cannot fully answer, how much it will cost. The cultures is, I think, if it would go the way we hope, would be almost the same as a bone marrow culture would cost, as treatments which are these days accepted in the clinical care. It should be feasible to do that in children. We start now the trials in adults because it's more easy to get ethical approval to do that, to show this first step, because for children we would not be able to do. And what was the second question? I forgot the one in the middle.
Does it work on kids, and how often does it have to be done?
Yeah, the good thing of administering stem cells would be that you would not have to do that often. But also that is something obviously we have to find out by doing the clinical trials. But the whole idea of administering stem cells is that they can indeed recreate the muscle, but you don't have to do that every other week.
Okay, and the final question I would like to do, how many locations would you need to inject this? Is this like one location where you have to do this treatment, mm-hmm. or would this be over the entire body?
Well, that is also a very good question. What we inject the cells is at the arteries which move to the muscle which needs to be treated, because if you do it in the veins, then those cells disappears in the lungs or at other. So we have to indeed to define a very careful administration pattern based on the muscles we would like to target. But it can be that you have to target that at multiple points in the body. Yeah.